Welcome as we gather to worship this week, and as we look forward to the weeks ahead, worshiping in celebration of Easter and our risen Savior. So we gather together in his name. Amen. Welcome as we gather again to worship together. May God bless your time in worship. We gather in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Salvation and renew a right spirit within me. spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me.
May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you by his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Old Testament reading is from Jeremiah chapter 31. Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, my covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, declares the Lord. For this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my law within them, and I will write it on their hearts. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And no longer shall each one teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, Know the Lord. For they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Good morning. Do you know what a covenant is? That is not a word that we use very often. A covenant is kind of like a promise, but even more so. Sometimes we make promises like, I promise I'll clean up my room this weekend, or I promise just one more video game and then I'll start my homework. Sometimes we keep those promises, sometimes we don't. But covenants are very special kind of promises. Promises that have something that prove that we intend to keep them. Like if we make a promise to a best friend, we might share with them a best friend bracelet. Well, sometimes best friends make such a promise that they stand up in front of all the people they know, their friends and family, and make a promise in front of everyone that they'll love each other forever, and they will live as husband and wife. That's a covenant, a promise that everyone witnesses, and that there's something to prove that you intend to keep the promise. Well, God made a covenant with us, more than one. First, he put a rainbow in the sky as a promise that he would never send a flood to cover the earth again, but instead would protect his people through a very different way. Another covenant that he made was to Abraham, where he said, "Look up at the stars. I make a covenant with you that I will make your family a great nation, and that your family will be called my people, and I will send my salvation to the world through your family." And he did with Jesus. And with Jesus, God made a new covenant. He said, "No longer will people wonder who God is, but I will write my name on their hearts, and they will know me." He established this new covenant and made it a permanent promise through our Holy Communion. When Jesus broke bread and gave the disciples the wine and said, "Take and eat, this is my body and my blood given for you as a new covenant to show you God's love through these elements to prove his promise to you that he is your God and he will do whatever it takes to bring you back to him. God's new covenant is all about his promise to us to call each of us his very own and do whatever it takes to bring us forgiveness and his love. Jesus came to bring us that new promise through his blood, through his death, and his new life that he shares with us. The Old Testament lesson is from Hebrews chapter 5. "For every high priest chosen from among men is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. He can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sins, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes this honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, 'You are my son, today I have begotten you.' As he also says in another place, 'You are a priest forever, after the order of Melchizedek.' In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered. And being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest after the order of Melchizedek. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God."
Please join me as we share our faith as held in the Apostles' Creed. We speak together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Gospel lesson is from Mark chapter 10. "And they were on the road going up to Jerusalem, and Jesus was walking ahead of them. And they were amazed, and those who followed were afraid. And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was about to happen to him, saying, 'See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes. And they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles. And they will mock him and spit on him, and flog him and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise.' And James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came up to him and said to him, 'Teacher, we want you to do for us
whatever we ask of you. And he said to them, what do you want me to do for you? And they said to him, grant us to sit, one at your right hand and one at your left, in your glory. Jesus said to them, you do not know what you are asking. Are you able to drink the cup that I drink, or to be baptized with the baptism with which I am baptized? And they said to him, we are able. And Jesus said to them, the cup that I drink, you will drink. And with the baptism with which I am baptized, you will be baptized. But to sit at my right hand or at my left is not mine to grant, but it is for those for whom it has been prepared. And when the 10 heard it, they began to be indignant with James and John. And Jesus called them to him and said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers over the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. Whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I will follow you. Yeah.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
One of my favorite movies is The Christmas Story. Now, you may remember this. It's a story about a young boy. The main character is 9-year-old Ralphie. And more than anything else in the world, Ralphie wanted a Red Ryder BB gun. But every time he mentioned it, he would get rebuffed. Ralphie asked his mother for the BB gun, and she said, "No, Ralphie, you'll shoot your eye out." So Ralphie thought that he could get his teacher to be an ally in the quest for his BB gun. So he writes an essay outlining the virtues of the Red Ryder BB gun. His teacher returned it with a grade of something like C+, with a note that said, "You'll shoot your eye out." So Ralphie, not giving up, goes to the department store Santa Claus. After telling Santa what he wanted, Santa responds, "You'll shoot your eye out, kid," and he shoved poor Ralphie with his boot down a long slide. Finally, morning comes, and Ralphie scrambles down to the gifts under the tree. The last gift Ralphie opens is, and you guessed it, his very own Red Ryder carbine action 200-shot range model BB air rifle. So Ralphie puts some BBs in the rifle, takes it outside, and with his very first shot, gets a BB that bounces back and hits him in his eyeglasses. Poor Ralphie. You have to be careful what you ask for. In today's gospel, we hear about a couple of Ralphies, a couple of brothers who were asking for something that clearly they did not completely understand. We find James and John, the sons of Zebedee, asking Jesus for a very special privilege. Hear again Mark's word in his Gospel, chapter 10, verses 35 to 40. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. "Teacher," they said, "we want you to do for us whatever we ask." "What do you want me to do for you?" he asked. And they replied, "Let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory." "You don't know what you are asking," Jesus said. "Can you drink the cup I drink or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with, but to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared." Now, do you hear in the question the selfishness? It's a basic question that we all have at times, isn't it? What can you do for us? The question, besides being self-serving, shows that James and John have a very common misunderstanding about Jesus. Context is always very helpful in understanding the text. Jesus was born at a time when the nation of Israel was under the military control of the Roman Empire. The people of Israel were looking for a powerful messianic figure to come onto the scene and deliver them from Roman oppression. When Jesus arrived, he was not recognized as the Messiah because he came as a meek and humble servant. Nevertheless, the thought of the all-powerful king ruler was never far from the minds of the Jewish people. And because of this thinking, James and John were asking Jesus for privileged seats by his side. They wanted to be seen in seats of power. What James and John didn't understand was how God understood glory. The concept that James and John held about glory came from the notion of a powerful Messiah. Glory to them was about conquest of the enemy. It was about Israel becoming the center of the world. Glory was about ruling in authority and power given by God. So when the request to be at Jesus' right and left was made, it was truly a request to be at the center of power. Now, we all know people who have given up everything in order to get to the top. maybe we have done so ourselves, given up or jeopardized our integrity, maybe marriage or family, and at extreme, even our lives. The lure may be the next promotion, the chance at being next to the seat of power, being able to call the boss by his or her first name, all for the chances of the brass ring, the reasons that so many people get up in the morning, for what they live for, climbing the ladder, recognition, honor, position, glory, and power. Most don't really understand the cost of what they are pursuing, so be careful what you ask for. Now, don't hear me say that hard, honest work is bad. That's not the point. It's when the pursuit of success, however you may define it, overtakes you and drives all that you do. Many of you know of George Stephanopoulos, a political commentator and co-anchor on the TV program Good Morning America. He was a Rhodes Scholar and a driven idealist, out to make a difference. He really wanted to contribute, to make his mark on society by helping other people, like so many try to do. He signed on the presidential campaign for Bill Clinton in 1992. This took him to the very pinnacle of power. He spent 4 years just a few feet away from the most powerful man in the world. But years of backroom scheming, screaming, and relentless political attacks took a toll. George paid a price: his health, his reputation, and before it would cost him his integrity, he resigned. He realized the pitfalls before it was too late. But how many people do not? When ambition drives us, it makes the rarefied air of power incredibly addictive. And it seems James and John were also driven by this as well. They wanted to be like Jesus. A good thing, but they didn't quite have a grasp of the big picture. Understanding what glory really is, in the eyes of God, in the person of Jesus, is a key to learning how to live our lives with our desires. As we look at our own ambitions, how do they stack up or compare with Jesus? Now, before you say anything, I know we cannot really compare ourselves to God, but Scripture encourages us to look to Jesus as the example. St. Paul tells us, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should not look only to your own interests, but also to the interests of others." Jesus had to sort out for his disciples what it meant to be one of his followers, to be at his left and his right. He had to correct the flawed thinking of the disciples, who cherished the idea of being in charge and being the boss. He had to tell them that it was the unbelievers who thought like this. It is the unbelievers who try to rule over their brothers and sisters. He called them to the very, very high standard of servanthood. So how is the Christian supposed to respond? By imitating Jesus? By becoming a servant like Jesus did? By becoming a slave to all? "Even I," Jesus is saying, "even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Glory in the kingdom of Christ is measured by the standard of self-giving that the Son of Man established as he gave his life as a ransom for many. Hear again how Jesus explained greatness to his followers in verses 32 to 34. "And he," Jesus, "took the 12 aside and told them what was going to happen to him. 'We are going up to Jerusalem,' he said, 'and the Son of Man will be betrayed to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death and hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him and kill him. 3 days later, he will rise.'" From God's point of view, Glory means to lose everything to serve others, to permit others to find joy and fulfillment, maybe even at our expense. God was willing to surrender it all so that we can have it all. Glory is about the sacrifice, as Jesus said to his disciples, to let condemnation and mocking and suffering and finally death on a cross come upon him for our sakes. Jesus paid the price. Ever think about who was on the right and left of Jesus as he entered his glory? When he was hanging on that cross, there were two thieves. Are we sure we want to be on Christ's left and right in his glory? Can you drink of the cup? Can you be baptized with the baptism? James and John, confidently, if not bravely, answered, "We can." And in the long run, they did suffer as their Lord did. But in the short term, at Gethsemane, on the night of the betrayal and the arrest of Jesus, the cup was too bitter and the baptism too fiery. They ran. We do not need to drink of that cup. Our Lord already endured the bitterness of that cup and survived the fire of that baptism. You see, the glory to Christ was about the cross. Glory to Christ was about winning our forgiveness and securing our place in heaven. Glory to Christ was about you and me. Our quest for the top rung, for the ultimate glory, has already been secured in Christ. In him, we are on the track to a heavenly eternity. May the glory of the cross be yours. Amen. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And it is. Amen.
Registration is now available on the website at stphilipchurch.com/Easter, where you can register to reserve a space for yourself on Easter morning at 10 a.m. for the in-person service. Our space is limited to 75, and so this will give us an idea of how many people to expect. Thank you, and we look forward to worshiping Jesus with you for this very special service. You are also invited to be part of our Holy Week services on Monday, Thursday at 7 p.m. in the sanctuary, where we'll be celebrating First Communion for two of our confirmands. And on Good Friday, we will have a YouTube service so you may worship at home. We will look forward to worshiping God during this special Holy Week season as we remember his good gift of his salvation that he won for us on the cross and his new life that he brings to us through Easter. Families with elementary children or grandchildren are invited to come to the church on Easter Saturday, April 3rd, between 2 and 3 p.m. to pick up a special Easter bag of treats and an Easter storybook as a gift from St. Philip to our children. Please let me know in the office if you are able to come by, so we'll have a bag prepared for you. If you have any prayer requests, you can submit them to the church office at admin@stphilipchurch.com or go to the website, stphilipchurch.com. Our prayer team meets every Tuesday to pray about the concerns of our congregation. We would love to pray for you and your concerns as a part of the family of St. Philip Church.
After each prayer petition, I will say, "Lord, in your mercy," you are invited to respond with, "Hear our prayer." Lord, we come before you this day with our petitions, trusting in your promise to hear us when we come before you. For health and healing, we raise up Angela, Malia, Beta, Joyce, Lauren, Lisa, Reed, Vince, John, Gyneth, George, Trevor, and Valerie. Lord, you know what is needed for each person. Be with them and provide the comfort that comes only from you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray strength and solace for those mourning the loss of a loved one. Especially this day, we raise up Darlene, who mourns the loss of her Aunt Joan, and William, who mourns the passing of his wife, Home. Lord, provide comfort to Darlene and William during their time of grieving. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We raise up Alyssa and Jared, who are recently married. We pray for a blessed union that you will always be invited into their marriage. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for Hannah that she will have a safe delivery of a baby boy. For all children as they return back to school. We give you thanks for the rain that we have had this year, and we do pray for more as we begin to look ahead to the summer months and the dry season. And Lord, so many families are affected by the COVID virus. We pray your healing on all. For the congregation of St. Philip and the church leaders, may they remain encouraged and strengthened by your Holy Spirit during this time of ministry transition. For these and all other prayers we have on our hearts that we raise up to you at this time, trusting that you do hear our prayers, and that with that promise, we are bold to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with his favor and give you his peace. Amen. Peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.